Today, we have again Anders Lavie, one of our most prolific speakers from the Department of Chemistry, and he's going to speak on a very important topic, speeding up Python for scientific computing. I know in our department here at the IKP, we've been transitioning to using almost exclusively Python, so this is an excellent seminar for teaching you really how Python works and how you can use some tools to really go through, diagnose your code, and get it to speed up. Yeah? So without any further ado, I give you Anders.
So I will start actually by saying something about what I mean about the title. So I've written something in very small writing here, and that is the assumption I will use in this talk, and that is that the Python code you have is actually pretty good. It's almost as good as it can be in Python. So this talk will not be as much about how you can do, how you can write better Pythonic code, but it's taking you more to the next level. Say your code is as Pythonic as it can be, but it's still 100 times slower than what you would have in Fortran and C. So we will go through some things you can do to approach C and Fortran speeds with Python. So this is one example of what I have been doing in my work. I'm postgrad chemistry department, where we develop a code for doing molecular dynamics, basically. And the most expensive thing in molecular dynamics is to evaluate forces between pairs of particles. And if you do that in Python, you have to do a double loop, which is very slow. But you can do it with NumPy. It will speed up maybe 10 times, 100 times. And you can do it in C. And it will speed up maybe 1,000 times. And that is, of course, a big difference when you're doing simulations. So that is basically what we will discuss in this lecture. And to make it more practical, we will go through one example of 2D diffusion, which I hope is familiar to most of you. We'll discuss how we can profile that code to see what parts are slow. We'll try to understand a bit more what Python is actually doing and why it is slow. We will see how NumPy will be able to help us solve some of those problems, and then finally, how we can do stuff with C or Fortran to make it go even faster. So if you have brought your computer or even your phone, you can look at the slides and some of the examples if you go to this address. And you can try to run some of the scripts we will be running here. But to jump into the problem we will be looking at, so we will solve this equation in two dimensions, which describes diffusion. And we are given some initial condition, just a function, and we have periodic boundary conditions. And to write down that solution numerically is actually not too hard. It's basically just evaluating the derivatives numerically. So I can do that in x direction by using these three items, and in the y direction with these three items. So I'm solving it now in a 2D grid. And this is actually not pseudocode for solving it. This is actually Python code for solving it. And this modular operator now just takes care of the periodic boundaries. So this is what I now would write in Python to solve it numerically. And just to show you a short movie of what this actually is, or what you get when you solve it for some initial condition. So this could be thought of as a high concentration in some shape. And then you let it evolve in time, and you see that it spreads out. So this is diffusion in 2D. And this is what we will be solving now. So I actually had written down some Python code for solving it. This is maybe in more detail. So we are giving a grid in two dimensions, and we will loop over that grid and update the concentration using numerical derivatives, which I right here. And why not try to run that with Python? So this is actually, if you have the examples, it's the file called diffusion Python 1. Here I write some more details about what this method is actually doing. But then this is just solving that equation numerically. And I define that I will do 100 steps. I define the size of the grid. So I have a very old laptop, so I'll use a very small grid for doing this. You can try bigger grids if you're trying it yourself on a newer laptop. And then I have given some time step for which I will evolve these equations in time. And then I have some method giving me the initial condition. But the main part of this program is just these lines, which are updating concentration and solving the equations numerically. So if I run into my computer, it will just do 100 steps in some seconds. And it might appear fast, but that's actually quite slow, very slow. And what we need to know is, why is it slow and where is it slow? And this is now a very easy question to answer here, because I only have one function doing stuff. So I would not really need to profile this program in great detail. This is, well, no matter what, I would say that this is the first step you should always do when you have some code you want to speed up. You need to know where it's slow before starting to optimize it. So I was thinking that we will just look at three different tools for doing that. One is called C Profile. That is more useful if you have maybe a big program and you want to know exactly what function is slow. So it gives you sort of an overview. And then we have the Line Profile. It gives you more details of a function. It will tell you the cost of each line in a function. So the idea is to use C Profile to figure out what function is slow, and then Line Profile to figure out what part of that function is slow. And then I have another tool, which is more general, not just for Python. You can use it for, well, anything in Linux, probably also a Mac. And it gives you some more metrics about your program, what's happening and why it might be slow. And we will use that last. So I will just start by showing you C Profile and how it works and what you can get out from it. Typical usage is something like this. So it's called like you would call a Python script. You tell it to include C Profile, and then you can give it some options to sort the output. So here it's just sorted by cumulative time spent in each function. So C Profile will look at each function you're calling and then measure how much time it spent in that function. So if we try that one, and then look at the output, it's a really big list. Because now I'm actually importing NumPy behind the scenes, and then it's a very, very big list of lots of imports happening, and very difficult to actually get something useful for this. So I actually recommend you to try a graphical tool for doing this, which will give us sort of a better overview, and that is called gprof2dot. So let's try that one and see what we can get from that. So now it's a two-step process. I first run the profiler again to get some output. I will then have to read that output with another program. Let's try that. And I can make a PDF, say. So this is something more useful. Each box here is actually one function. And these are all the functions that's being called. So there is a lot of them happening here. The color is what's important there. Red is something that takes up a lot of time. And it goes from red to blue via green and yellow, or yellow and green. So if I were to look into these little boxes, they all have some name, and they all have some numbers. So this first number is the amount of time spent in that function. And the second number is the actual amount of time that function is doing work. So what's the difference? 100% is the time spent in that function and all its children. But just 0.15% of that time is actually that function doing some work. So if we want to know what part is the most expensive here, we have to sort of follow the red arrows down. And if we do that, we will arrive down here. So it's actually, this function is using almost 90% of the time, and almost all that time is used inside that function. So this is a sign that this is the most expensive function in this program. Of course, that is something we could have guessed before now, since it's only actually one big function doing all the work. But if you had, I would just show you another example from another program I ran this on, where it's perhaps more useful. So this is the kind of output you will get. And you'll get all these little boxes with different colors. And you can use that to find where is the most expensive function, or what should I start to optimize. So again, this is actually one function just almost doing not any work, just calling another function, which is not doing much work, calling another function, and so on down. So I have to follow this all the way down until I arrive at this point. Then I see a function that is using a lot of time and is actually doing a lot of work. So in this case, it also shows me that, well, this function up here is calling three functions, which are calling more functions, but they all sort of arrive down here using that function. So it means that that function takes up a lot of time, and it's called by many parts of my program. So this is a good candidate for updating something, or sorry, optimizing something. I will pick that one first. So C profile is really something to use if you want to know where you should optimize. So let's say that we have figured out where to optimize. Then one question could be to try to figure out what part of that function should I really optimize to look into. And that is something we can figure out by using a line profiler. So it will basically look through some function or functions you select line by line and measure the time spent on that on the particular different lines. So the way I call it is I'm using a tool called kernproof. I give it a minus L, which tells me I want to do it line by line. I give it a minus V, which tells me to tells the program to write stuff to the screen. But before doing that, I have to mark the function I'm interested in. And that's done by adding a Python decorator in front of it, just something called at profile. So this will mark that function. So we can also just look at the output from that profiler on our diffusion problem. So I first have to mark the function I'm interested in with this decorator. And then I will actually run fewer steps. Because using this particular profiler will slow down the execution of the program maybe 10 times or 100 times. So it's actually much, much slower now. But that's just because the profiler is trying to figure out what my program is doing. So I said minus L was line by line, and minus V to print output. Let this let it work for some time. Well, I can maybe. Yes, hope this will look better on the screen. So it will give me a table for that function I picked to use it on. And it will tell me percentage of the time, for instance, and how many times each line were executed. So now it's just also displaying all the comments ahead. But here is the actual interesting data now. It tells me that most of the time in this function is spent inside the actual calculation, the actual numerical integration. And I guess that's what I really want in this program. I don't want to spend time on anything else. You could think that this line, for instance, were maybe not so useful to do over and over again. I'm just creating a new matrix, basically. And I'm doing it many times. So you can actually remove that line and rather use two matrices in this calculation. I can just show you what that will look like. So I can change the function to take in actually two matrices. I then use one for updating the other, and then just switch them around afterwards. So in that sense, I can save a tiny bit. But still, it will not give me a massive speed up in this case. And the reason is that most of the time is actually spent in this numerical integration. So no surprises so far, I would say. The most expensive function is the one that's actually doing all the work. That was what I would guess beforehand. So then you might ask, but why is this so slow in a way? Because it's not doing anything particularly fancy. It's just adding some numbers and maybe multiplying them. And why is that so slow when you do it in Python? And the question, or the answer to that is actually that Python is doing some extra work, sort of. Because when you execute the Python script, it's turned into Python bytecode, which is just binary. And that is then executed by Python, typically C Python, which is an implementation written in C. And then it will look up that bytecode in a big, big switch statement. I will show you that one in a few seconds, and try to figure out what the different commands mean. So this is actually something you can look at if you want to know exactly what Python is doing with some function. There's a module called DIS, and it can be used to look at what the bytecode some function you write is actually translated to. So this is the typical output if I run it on some function or command. It will give you a list, basically, of operations that Python is now doing. For instance, it will load a name, and it will binary add, and it will store that name. And these are all operations that C Python is finding in this enormous switch statement. So this is the source code for Python, say. So it's actually reading these different operations and try to find them here in this big, big switch statement. So we can look for that binary add, say. Let's see, here it is. So as you can see, this is a lot more than just adding two numbers. So Python is sort of doing extra work now, because it does not know that we actually want to add two integers, say. It will try to figure out types and see what it should do when adding these numbers. So if I go back, I have some more examples of this, how you can use it. You can just import it. You can just use it on a string which represents a function, for instance. And here you can see that Python is not entirely stupid. If you tell it to add 1 plus to it, it will say that this will just be a constant 3. So here it will not just try to add 1 and 2 over and over again. It will just define it as a constant. Same if you do add it to a variable. So this module, DIS, can tell us exactly what Python is doing on a very low level. So the reason why I'm showing you this is because we can use it to sort of understand why Python sometimes is slow. So here I will just show an example where I will create some random numbers and then just sum them with two different functions. One I did write myself is just looping over numbers and adding them together. And the second one is very short, it's just using the built-in sum function of Python. Okay, so let's try to time these two ways of doing the sum. Now I'm running the first one and the second one. So the second one was much slower, but it did the same loop 10 times longer because each loop was much faster. So we figured out, okay, I can measure for a longer time before I start getting impatient. So it was actually quite much faster than the first loop. But what's the difference between these two functions? Well, the easiest way, I think, to answer that is to look at what Python is going to do when I run these two functions. So if you look at the first one, it's actually doing a lot of work. This part is what's doing the actual loop. Lots of instructions for adding numbers and loading constants and so on. But if you look at this other function, much fewer instructions. So it's just using a built-in function that's actually doing a sum quite fast in C. And the actual Python code is much, much shorter. And it's a general sort of rule of thumb that if you have a long bytecode, or if you compare two functions and one has longer bytecode, the one with the longer bytecode typically slower. So we can use this now to try to invent a function that is even slower than the first one I had. And that is to do a while loop, because then I have to do additional operations to get the number and to check if I should stop. And let's just make that function and try to time it. And it was even slower than my slowest one from the last go. And we can look at the bytecode for this. Well, it's actually now quite a bit longer than the previous one. So the lesson from all this is that you can actually look at what Python is doing if you import this module. And this rule of thumb that if you have longer bytecode, it's slower code, usually. So the lesson learned is that Python is doing a lot of extra things, even if you want to add some integers. And this is typically bad for like the example I had previously, where I just want to do some additions, and there'll be multiplications to update that grid I had. OK, this might maybe that will change in the future, that we can actually say what types that numbers are just numbers and not some other objects. But right now, you can't do that. So CPython, which we typically use, is actually not producing optimized bytecode in that sense. It's more optimized for running the bytecode it produces faster, which means that if we just run the bytecode it has produced fast, rather than to make the bytecode faster. And that's the difference. And actually, you don't have to just say that that's fine, but you can look at other implementations of Python which produce faster bytecodes. One example is PyPy. It's actually just an implementation of Python, which is not written in C. It's written in Python itself. And it comes with a just-in-time compiler, which will compile code into machine code. Typically, something it detects that you want you are using something over and over again, and it will try to compile that into machine code. And this means that it will run very much faster than just Python. So we can just try to see what happens now if I want to run with PyPy. Let's see. Just checking how many steps I put. 100. So this is just normal CPython. Took about 2 seconds. And I will just run the same example through PyPy. Quite a bit faster. And the reason for that is it's now compiling that updating of the grid into machine code. It can run much, much faster. The downside of PyPy is that this doesn't have full support for NumPy. Typically, if you run something where you use NumPy through PyPy, it would actually run slower. But it's very useful if you have some sort of pure Python code lying around and you just want to run through that faster. So that will be sort of my first advice for today, is just to try PyPy, because it typically does not require you to do any changes to your code. You can just run your script through it. But to understand a bit more, or to get some metrics on why PyPy is now faster than just the normal CPython, if you look through this final profiling tool, it's called PERF, or PERF as I pronounce it. I don't know if that's correct. Anyway, that's a tool with many, many answers. But then you sort of have to know what questions to ask it. And I have just one example question we can try to ask PERF, and that is we want to study something called cache misses. Because this is also something that's really important for Python code and making Python code a bit slower. That's the memory layout of Python objects. So we have to make a detour to see what this is all about. And in Python, like I used a list for storing my 2D grid. And these lists, they are very general, and they are sort of designed that simple lookups, they should be fast. But you can put almost anything you like into a list. You can put numbers, strings, functions, result to function objects anything. So Python cannot make many, well, it can make just a few assumptions how this is laid out in memory. And instead of storing the actual data, the list is storing pointers to where the data can be found. So if I were to do something like this, which I'm doing over and over again in that example, I want to look up some item in my grid. So this would translate to look up item number 2 or whatever you get when you look up item number 5. But rather, I would like it to be look up item 5.2, which would be faster. So again, we see that Python will do sort of extra work when it's trying to do this. But perhaps more crucial is that the Python list is not contiguous in memory necessarily, which means that it just contains some pointers to where stuff can be found in memory. And this can be like this silly example where it's just crisscrossed everywhere. And that is actually going to slow things down. We will see why in just a second. This is one of the reasons why going to NumPy will actually help us now. Because NumPy arrays, they are laid out simpler in memory because they are just one type. They're just integers, they're just floats. So it's very easy to sort of know where item 3 would be. You can, like in C, you can it sort of translate to C. If I look up some item, I can do it this way, or I can just increase the pointer. It will get me to the right position. So that is a big benefit of going to NumPy. And the reason why this sort of makes things slower in Python is the way computers work. So this is sort of my image of how they work. So your Python script is asking your computer to find some item. OK, that's easy to find. It's just here. But then the computer tries to be sort of nice to you or clever. It will think that, OK, he will probably ask for this item next. So I will transfer this to another place, keep them ready for when he's asking for it. And the problem now is this would work if everything is laid out perfectly in memory, so that items come after each other in memory. Because memory is transferred in sort of chunks. But now, this does not necessarily happen in Python. So the chunk I get might not be the chunk I really want. So this is now stored in the so-called cache. And when I ask for the next item, if it's in the cache, it's OK. Everything is perfect. If it's not, it counts as a cache miss. And then I have to go, well, the computer has to go back into memory and fetch that number and a chunk around it. So this will make Python lists less suited for numerical computations. And another reason why this is not so good, it's because of vectorizations. Because normal computers, they're actually sort of very parallel in some sense. You have several levels of running parallel things. You have MPI, which might be my computer and your computer collaborating, sort of, or running something. And then you have OpenMP, say, where because my computer has several CPUs and they can work together. And then I have something called SCMD, which are basically instructions which allow one CPU to do more operations at the same time. And that's what I'm trying to show with this picture down here. So if I'm adding some numbers, I can add one number and another number, add one number and next number, and so on. Or I can add a bunch of numbers at the same time. This is something you can do with SCMD. Typically, if you're writing C or Fortran, this is something that you hope the compiler will figure out for you and compile your code so this is happening. This is not happening at all with CPython. CPython is not exploiting that fact that you can run operations on numbers. You can run process more numbers at the same time. This is actually going to slow down. We're slowing down Python a lot. The good news is that even though CPython will not vectorize stuff, PyPy can to some extent. If it will not magically turn your list into something more useful for numerical computations. But as I briefly mentioned, the NumPy way of storing stuff is better suited for this. So NumPy can vectorize to some extent. And best of all, you can. When you're writing C or C++ or Fortran, typically if you're writing it correctly, things will be vectorized. But to just get some metrics about these cache misses I was talking about. I have this final profiling tool. I will not actually run this command. I will just tell you that it exists, and I will use it to measure different versions of this diffusion equation I have now. It basically, I tell it to run with an option stat, which is collect statistics. I tell it to, with this minus b, to print stuff prettier. I tell it to select certain events I want to monitor. So this will give you me information of how many cycles I did, how many instructions my computer did, how many times it tried to find something in the cache, how many times it missed. And this is something extra I threw in just to show you that computers are actually, they are quite smart. So if you have an if statement, that counts as a branch. And when the computer comes to that branch, it will try to guess, OK, where are you going next? I'm guessing that you're going in this direction. It will prefetch instructions. And this, if this is correct, perfect, everything will be fast. If it's not correct, it will count as a branch miss. But still, the computer is actually quite good at guessing what's happening in an if statement. The final thing I included here, which I did not write in the list, is that I just want to repeat this command 3 times to gather statistics. But rather than executing that, I will show you the output I got from Python and PyPy. As you can see, the biggest difference here is the number of cycles it took to complete and the number of instructions I had to do to complete it. That's basically the biggest differences, I would say. And also, of course, that since PyPy did it in fewer cycles and instructions, it, of course, did fewer branches also. But the cache situation was about the same. PyPy does not magically turn my list into something more useful for numerical computation. To summarize these numbers, I got actually, just by using PyPy, I got a factor of 20 faster code in this case, which corresponds well with sort of doing 20 less instructions. So PyPy will give you better performance without changing the code at all, typically. But then we want to do better, sort of. We want to make it run even faster. And then we need a better way of representing that grid I had in memory. And that will NumPy do for me. So this is not an introduction to NumPy. I will just use it sort of to see what you can get from it. So we get a better representation of the arrays. You can get vectorization. You get actually quite nice tools for integrating your C code or Fortran. And the biggest reason I would say to use NumPy is to get this massive library of useful functions, which you can then continue to use on your data. Without saying too much more, this is now my diffusion example in NumPy. So this is very typical, I would say, of what happens when you write things with NumPy. Much shorter, all the loops are gone. I will use whole array operations instead. And I will make use of the NumPy functions. So here I actually make use of one function called roll. It will take in my grid, move it 1 unit along axis 0. So this means I'm shifting it along the x direction. And then that function is made so that sort of, you know, shifting it outside the boundary, it will reappear on the other side. So this is actually taking care of that periodic boundaries I had in my boundary conditions. And I can do the same, shift it in the negative direction, still along the x-axis. I can shift it in positive direction along the y-axis, and the negative direction along the y-axis. So this is essentially calculating a numerical derivative now. And then I'm just updating the whole grid by just a whole array operation. And let's try that one to see what that looks like. There we are. So this is the whole function. And I can try to use the same size I did for the Python example. But now it sort of finishes almost instantaneously. So it's much, much faster now with NumPy. Basically because I'm getting a much better representation of how of this two-dimensional array I'm using. I did not tell you, but I actually now, when I did the initial conditions now, I created this grid as an NumPy array from the start. So it's using that from the start. Of course, now with NumPy, you have lots of options to play around with both the library and both the way of calling things and using these matrices. And one option is to perhaps replace this function, which actually will create a new array, do a copy with something else. And you can, of course, do that. I guess it's much less readable if you don't use NumPy. So this is just exploiting how you can use NumPy to extract certain slices, rows, and columns. So I don't know how familiar you are with this notation, but this will extract basically row 1 and onwards to the end, and all columns. This will extract everything from row 0, but not the last one, and all columns, and so on. So this will actually calculate my numerical derivative. The point with this example is that rather than doing this, where I actually create copies with roll, I can do everything in place. So I'm not doing extra copies of my arrays. So this will actually speed up things. Let's see if I have it here. Yep. So it will run slightly faster. If I now, I can actually, NumPy is not sort of perfect in aligning things in memory so that it would run fast. There are tools to make it even better. And one such example is actually one library you can use, which is called NumXPR. It will sort of align things better in the memory. It's very easy to use, so that's why I now include it in this example here, just to show you what you can get. It's basically just writing whatever I want to evaluate as a string, and then telling it to evaluate that. And that will automatically put in the variables and evaluate it for me. And the reason why this is useful, I can try to show you if I make a bigger grid, then it's more important to align things. Let's see. Okay, so this was the first example where I just use the roll function. And here I'm using in place additions and also this NumXPR library, so it's slightly faster. This is what I got when I did the measurements. This is the one where I just used this roll function. It's a lot faster than pure Python. And this is the one where I took these numerical slices and did everything in place and also used NumXPR. So now we're sort of already 100 times faster than almost that we were with just pure Python. But this requires us to make bigger changes to the code, which I, in this case, I think is sort of OK, because we get everything in sort of NumPy language, which means that we can make use of the rest of the NumPy library and everything around that for plotting and storing data and so on. So the final thing I wanted to discuss is, of course, that sometimes we want even bigger gains. And that then we have to write stuff ourselves in C or Fortran. And in Fortran, it's actually very easy. It's basically just writing pure Fortran and compiling it with a special tool called F2Py, which comes with NumPy. C, it can be more involved depending on how you want to do it, actually. I will discuss how to use the briefly how to use the C API, which is pretty involved, I would say. But you have full control of what's happening. So the steps to do it with Fortran is to write code in Fortran to do the computation, compile it with F2py, and then import it and use it in Python. So it's, I would say, pretty straightforward. There are some, I can actually open up file rather. So here I have written some Fortran code to do the actual diffusion routine. It looks slightly different, I would say. I have to give it some more inputs now. I have to give it input grid. I have to give it a time step that I did also in the pure Python version. But now I have to tell it how many rows there should be in this matrix, how many columns there are, and I have to give it some place to store the output. And what's really important now is to mark things either as you intend it to be input or you want it to be output. And it's sort of marked in the standard Fortran way by writing intent in or out. And yeah, the actual Fortran code I did write is not very pretty, but it sort of does the job. So the next step when I have written all this is to compile it. And I usually do it with just a makefile. You have to specify what F2py you want to use. Sometimes, like on this computer, I have many different versions of Python. So here I say I want to use basically something that we compile for Python 3.5. I have to tell it what compiler to use. I have to tell it what module to make to read. So I can just compile that. And when that is done, it will create this file. And this is something I now can include in my Python script. And that is actually very straightforward. It's basically just saying that import it from that name. And then using it, it's also very simple because F2py is doing something or a lot behind the scenes. And as you see now, this is different from the way I wrote that function in the Fortran routine. In the Fortran routine, I had more stuff here. I had row, column, grid, out. But F2py will read Fortran code, see that I marked it as intent in and out, and it will recognize that these two are actually just the dimension of the matrix, and it will turn those two variables optional, which means that I don't need to include them. I can do if I want to. And it will also see that I marked this grid out as intent out, and that will allow me to actually call a function like this, which is, I would say, a nicer way of calling it. So it's appears as a real function and not just a sort of subroutine that changes some of my input variables. So that's basically all there is to include Fortran. So I can also try running that. Just see, okay, yeah. I just run it on a much bigger grid this time. But there is no one complicating fact, and that is Fortran and C store arrays differently in memory. C would like to put one row, then the next row, and then the next row, because even though it's a 2D matrix, it's just one-dimensional memory. Fortran would like to take column 1, there, column 2, column 3, and so on. So it's all column-wise. And if you don't tell Python about this or F2py, F2py will automatically copy the matrix you have from NumPy into the correct order. Because typically in NumPy, since everything is C Python, it's in row order. But you want it in column order for use with Fortran. You can also tell it explicitly to take one array and turn it into a Fortran array. But still, you don't really need to have to think about that for using Fortran. And the nice thing then is that I can just, in my Fortran code, here. I can just loop over that grid as it appears as a 2D array. So that's quite convenient. One thing that this means, of course, is that if I were to loop over rows first and then columns, as you probably know from Fortran, this will be slower than looping over columns first and then rows, because F2Py makes sure that the input is in Fortran order. So that's the detail. So then when I try this for a bigger case, I get quite a massive speed up compared with the original Python code. Now it's 300 times faster almost. But I did not write particularly good Fortran code for this. And I have a slightly better C code, which I will show you. But the downside about C now is that it's sort of, you have to write more code to do the same thing. Lot of boilerplate code to actually get somewhere. And it's maybe tedious, it depends on what you like, but you have no full control. You can actually use, if you have an Intel computer, you can use this fast vectorized instructions if you sort of know exactly what you're doing. Because it's very easy to write, think you're writing fast code, but it's actually much, much slower because you didn't quite think of how things are organized in memory and so on. But anyway, now I compile things with a Python file. And I will first show you what the C code might look like now. So both the Fortran code I had and the C code are actually communicating with my Python script sort of through a NumPy array, just because it's a very convenient way of storing data. So I will not say too much about the C code, except that I have to include some Python headers, some headers from NumPy, some math, which I don't think I'm actually using here. Well, forgot that one. And then you have to say what functions there are in this method, and then you have to say in this library, and then you have to say what methods there are in this library, and this is just the list of the function you want to include. And then you have to basically add a lot of code to get somewhere before finally you can start writing your numerical functions now. In this way, the input to my function is just some arguments, and that is actually parsed down here. This. So then you have to know what stuff to put in here. This is an object, another object. This is a double number. This is a long int, and so on. And then I have to cast everything from the input I got into, I'm saying that it's basically just NumPy floats, which is a special type. And then I can start looping. So if I want to have actually a 2D grid to loop over, I have to do something more. Now I'm just getting one big one-dimensional array with everything organized in rows after each other. So this makes things more complicated when I want to do my loop. Basically, I have to loop over all rows and all columns, and then calculate at what index that should be, and then look up those positions. Okay. There are ways to cast the stuff you get from NumPy into a 2D structure using that. But in this case, I didn't do that. I just went with the one-dimensional because I can always calculate the rows and columns and so on. And what I did know in this code, which was different from the Fortran code, is that I tried to remove some of the if statements I had. Why did I do that? Basically because then it's easier for the compiler to try to vectorize stuff. So I'm actually handling boundary conditions as two special cases, and then looping sort of all over the interior of my grid, so I don't have to worry about the boundary conditions inside there. And this will vectorize the code, making it faster. So the problem of it writing such low-level code is that it's not particular, it might not be particularly portable. So here I'm assuming that everything can be in 64 bits, which is a problem for this computer, which I didn't write it for because it's old one and everything is 32 bits, so it won't work on my computer. So to show you that example, I have to try it on another computer. So let's see. So I will try first the original NumPy grid. I'm doing the grids bigger now, doing more steps. On this other computer, it's still, let's say, reasonably fast. And then I can try the MyC code. Okay, same size. So I first need to compile it. And that is now done via a Python script. Okay, which would then create a file like this.
Is this the tab you write it yourself?
Yes, but it's sort of, it looks almost the same for all scripts you want to compile. You can just add compiler flags as you like, and then run it. I forgot what results I got. Okay, so now I'm comparing C with NumPy, and it's actually, let's see, more than 10 times faster than that again. So by going into C, I'm sort of making my code more and more specialized now, because NumPy is still quite general. Well, not very general, but now I'm making very few assumptions about the data I have. For instance, if somebody were to give me a Fortran array and pass that now into my C code, everything would be messed up because there are columns, columns, columns. I assume that there are rows, rows, rows. So it's much less general. But if I put in the right data, so to say, I will get a big speed up. And in my, well, when I compile it, I tell it to write actually an extra output file, which gives me some information on what the compiler did. And I basically just did that to look for statements like this. So here it manages actually to vectorize a loop. And that's on line 73. And that's this internal loop. What I could do, I could, for instance, loop over all the grid and have two if statements inside this to handle the border cases or sort of the boundary cases. And then the loop would not be vectorized. So here is a very big difference of where I put my stuff. Generally, if you can avoid having if statements inside your loops, that's very good. This is now the results, sort of all the results I have for going from Fortran to C, NumPy and PyPy and so on. And in the end, the speed up at C is actually, well, almost 500 times faster. Fortran could also probably be 500 times faster and about the same speed as C. Here I'm writing actually sort of poor Fortran code because I didn't spend too much time on that one. This is one suggestion I got to try where I actually add extra rows and columns somewhere on my grid to just be the boundary conditions so that I can just do something special on the grid. Sorry, the boundaries, and then the internal grid is just one simple loop. And that will actually speed up things somewhat more. So if I summarize all these findings in a graph, I have number of instructions and the time it took. It's a very big difference when going from just pure Python and down to Fortran or C code. And the number of instructions also falls down quite a lot. I can also look at the memory. There's not so much, or cache misses, it's not such a big difference if I go from Python to PyPy. but I can get sort of in the same range if I use NumPy or C or Fortran. So they are basically very similar in this respect. So this is the final thing I wanted to mention, because people are often worried about writing real parallel code, like with MPI or OpenMP, or maybe just simply using threads for speeding up your code to do more stuff at the same time. And in Python, it's not useful at all to use threads, because Python will just execute one byte code statement at a time. So even if you use threads, it will just do one thing at a time anyway. But they are very useful in your extensions. If you write in C or Fortran, you can just add your parallel part there. So I can just show you what that might look like. If you want to use OpenMP, it's just typically adding some line like this. And then you can make use of more CPUs. There are, of course, libraries for Python that will allow you to do parallel execution. One is MPI for Py, and another one is multiprocessing. And they can be used to execute things in parallel. To sum things up now in the end, so we have looked at three ways to improve the performance of Python scripts. The first one was PyPy, which requires almost no change to the Python code, but it does not give you as much speed up. And then there is NumPy. Then you would have to actually maybe make more changes to your code, write NumPyic Python in some sense to make use of NumPy. And then you can do stuff with C or Fortran, which maybe take more time for you to actually do, unless you have maybe some Fortran code already in place, which would then be very simple to just call from Python. So I would say if you have some Python code, which is just pure Python, you want to try to see if you can execute it faster, you can just try PyPy. Otherwise, I would say go with NumPy, because you will also get a big library to use, and it also interacts well with Fortran, C, and C++, and so on. So if you want to really go down that road, you can do it. And final remarks then is that Python ecosystem is quite rich, and now this is maybe the best reason of using Python, is that there are so many libraries out there doing things for you. Especially for if you're doing scientific computing. You have libraries for numerical methods, you have libraries for storing your data and accessing them better, you have libraries for calling things from C. I think this library is very interesting. It will take Python code, turn it into vectorized C code, which is sort of help if you want to write vectorized C code. You can write things for parallel with NPI for Py. You can actually have a just-in-time compiler for NumPy. You can do multiprocessing. And then there are libraries for doing stuff on GPUs with large NumPy arrays. So with that, I would like to end. And also, I thank Magnus and Inge for many discussions about Python. So thank you for your attention also.
Thank you, Anders. I think we have time for a few questions, because the pizza baker has made some errors and our pizza won't be delivered for another 5 minutes. So if anybody has some questions, please. Yes?
I can say a few words about Pandas.
No, because I have not used it much, but I have only used it for storing data in column format. So basically, it's much faster than NumPy's built-in save text and load text, for instance. So if you have big data, I will go with Pandas. But I have just used it for simple stuff, saving an NumPy and reading one column or the second column and so on. But it's typically a lot faster than NumPy for reading.
Anyone
else? Yes. So, did you compare it with just a pure C approach without any
interface with Python? No, that would probably be faster. And it would be probably similar to the first code that you wrote there, or to the pure guide Python.
Mm.
Probably more or less the same length of code and much faster, I guess.
Yeah. I think it would be much harder to do this thing. Set up these initial conditions, for instance. Because here I can just tell Python to read a PNG and pick out the alpha value and use that as the concentration, for instance. So it depends on what you want to do. Yeah.
Yes.
Yep. Have you compared it with library-specific code using Theano? Because that's compiled to C, isn't it?
Yeah. No, I didn't compare it with this, actually. But I think it would be very interesting, especially because now I'm just solving. I've only done it for very small grids now. But if I were to look at massive grids, I would definitely try that, yeah.
Yes.
A friend and I, we're working on two different things. He's doing C# and I'm doing Python.
Yeah.
And it's big data, finance data. And we're trying to start with fundamental analysis. It's lots of data.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're adding even more data with daily data to kind of try to match different strategies that doesn't match well.
Mm-hmm.
There's some advantages with C# and then there's other advantages with Python in terms of simplicity and stuff. And then we're trying to do neural networks and all that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any tips for how how would you go about going towards a neural network in Python?
I'm not sure. I have to check, actually. Okay, maybe not. Oh, I don't know which package can do that for you, but I know there is something that can do it for you. Neural networks. And if you have really big data, have you also considered other ways of storing your data? What's it called?
Yeah, actually,
they're printed. Is
that the name? Wait, so we're not there quite yet.
Oh, sorry.
So right now, it's not so much data. And we're starting with daily data, and then we're moving it to minute data. And then it's getting.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
I'm just wondering if you have tried any of these methods on the graphical interfaces, just with buttons, and to see if there are some that can you use PyPy with Qt or PyQt. I never tried so.
No, I never tried graphically myself. I know you often run into troubles if you're using some. Try to use some libraries with PyPy because it's not supported.
It's not supported.
Mm. But for Qt, no, I don't know. I have not tried it.
Okay.
Nope.